Ladies and gentlemen, welcome and good evening. My name is Dragon Drop here for the D2CL Season 6 Priest versus the HellRaisers. CS, Dota at its finest. This is Group D, I believe, and I also think this is the upper brackets final, so to speak. There's a double elimination format in these groups. Only two will survive. And for the loser of this isn't quite out of it just yet. They're facing Alliance for that secondary spot out of Group D. So losing here is not the end of the world, but winning here definitely gets you where you want to go faster, which is the main event. So my name is Dragon Drop, as I said. I'm joined for this game number one, at least, by none other than SB Revolution 5, also known as Revo. How you doing, man?
I'm doing great. Happy to be back on the mic after quite a while here. And excited to see these teams. HellRaisers, haven't seen a lot out of them recently, but they are going through some roster changes, and they did say that this is going to be their experimental roster on their website in a news post earlier today. So excited to see what they're going to be doing that's new. And PRIES looking very strong recently. So.
Yeah, absolutely. So HellRaisers, they are missing Dread and Metpum, both of them left, and then instead they have the Apathy and Yamaha is that other stand in here according to the website. And funnily enough, Metpum is now playing for Priest, so at least standing in for the time being. So it's a little bit of a rivalry going on there just off of that. But yeah, Priest, we've seen them yesterday in the Go for the 2 Cup, and they kind of rolled over their position there, so they definitely know the stuff. They proper CAS Dota, as I mentioned. It's they're very good at what they do, very efficient farming from Bogdavajan, the Dekari player. Kind of crazy how much gold he was able to get on heroes that are not Alchemist, but yeah.
It was against Lemon Dogs and who else?
Mana 5 and then another Russian team, Siberian something. It's okay. Like a really, really hard name to remember, actually. But yeah, it looked kind of easy for them. So it's, yeah, I expect a good match here. HellRaisers, of course, they have been a staple in the tier 2 scene for quite a while. Looking at these names as well, there's plenty of skill for that, so it would still give them the edge, but I wouldn't count Priest out just yet.
Definitely. And we do see that Beastmaster first pick. This is a hero that didn't get a lot of love in the qualifiers, I felt like, but he was picked up from time to time. I know Monkey Business ran him once or twice, if I'm not mistaken.
Possibly, yeah. But the draft's already going quite fast. Beastmaster plus the Bane. It's a really interesting opening that I haven't really seen before. Queen of Pain, Earthshaker for Priest. Much more common these days. I mean, Earthshaker hasn't really fallen off. Lina has, though, so you don't really see that that particular opening combo all that often anymore. But Queen of Pain, solid hero, just because you don't just have to run on a mid. You can also run her in the off lane, on the safe lane. As long as it's a solo lane, she's fine, essentially. And then you have the Earthshaker who can, yeah, just roam around early, create space with a Fissure even with only what level 1, and then turn into a pretty strong teamfighter later on with lots of crowd control. So no big surprise there. HellRaisers, more focus on single target lockdown for the time being. Both of these ultimates go through BKB, so what do you make of that?
Well, it's obviously something to say, if you want to put a BKB carry, we're not going to let you do that. And now with the Tusk coming out for Priez, they say that's fine. Tusk probably going to be their offlaner, but now an IO coming up for HellRaisers. So do we see the Necro come out from this and get a third BKB piercing disable? Not to mention delete a hero from the game for a little while.
Probably not. I think HellRaisers are looking for something that can fight early together with the Wisp. I mean, of course, Tiny comes to mind, which Priest, I don't really think they want to pick that up just as a block pick, so they're just going to have to try and deal with it. So they go with Phantom Lancer, so not the most common counter to any sort of Wisp combo, but you already have the Queen of Pain and the Earthshaker, I guess. So Winter Wyvern, of course, also not available. Banned out in first phase. So yeah, it looks like a mid-Wisp Tiny against anything that Priest want to run there. Presumably the Queen of Pain at this point. Beastmaster offlane, and then the Bane plus one in the safe lane.
Now, I don't want to be the bearer of bad news here, but taking a look at Dat Dota real quick, there's been 35 Phantom Lancer games on the new patch. He's won 8 of those. It is... I looked at the nerfs and said, okay, well, it's a slight nerf. It's not too bad. No, it's pretty bad.
It is, yeah.
The cast point on Doppelganger just hurts so much because you can't get that instant phase shift anymore.
Yep.
It's now, okay, we have to actually time it. And there's a lot of situations where you don't have the opportunity to Tiny. Now, on the bright side for Priest, other than Tiny, they don't have a lot of AoE on HellRaisers. I mean, Beastmaster having those axes will do some work, but it won't really cut down the entire pack of illusions here. So HellRaisers really need a fifth pick, probably a mid, that's going to give them a lot of AoE clear. Legion comes into mind for me specifically because they banned out the Ember Spirit, and Legion is very good this patch, in my opinion.
Yeah. For HellRaisers, or for Priest,
of course, yeah.
I don't know. I feel like if you want to pick up a Legion commander, you need some big burst to go with it. Just make sure that you can get these dual wins, because without that, you're not exactly scaling. And that's silence. Okay, that's interesting, and I really love that. For one, it can instantly stop the Bane channeling his ultimate. So that's a hard counter there. And then, with some Tiny come in, if you throw out the silence, well, what are they going to do, right? And all of a sudden, they're caught out of position, Tiny can't stun lock and burst someone down. And that should give you enough space to either turn around with the Earthshaker, give him a little bit more time, or the Tusk to do the same kind of thing. Yeah, or just take a fight straight off the back of that. But Mirana, that's also here, that I haven't seen before in the Bane-Mirana combo. It is classic, to say the least.
Yeah, and Mirana does have a 54% win rate right now on the current patch. How they're going to lane this is going to be interesting. It looks like it's probably going to be like 2-2-1 with Mirana, Bane, Tiny, and Io. I mean, you could put those in either safe lane or mid, and they're going to do just fine. Yeah,
it's probably going to be the worst Tiny mid, Bane, Mirana. Yeah. It's kind of weird because you usually like to see that as a roaming combo instead of a one position Mirana, so maybe they want to go to the offlane to just try to make try to put some pressure on, leave the Beastmaster to the solo safe lane to get his quick levels and into easy farm. Or they
one
can just
Mirana
put
does
Mirana
have
one
though,
position.
Yeah, she does have that AoE clear though. It's not quite as strong as something like a Shaker or a Legion or even the Ember Spirit, but it does give you that Star Storm to hit all the illusions and say, okay, which one's real? It's that one. Get it. Now,
yep.
So it gives them a way to isolate a target for either Beastmaster or Bane to lock down, and hopefully Tiny or an Io to come through and burst down.
Alright, and with that, if you're just tuning in, welcome. My name is Dragondrop, I'm joined by Rebo here for this first game in the Dota 2 Champions League, this matchup between Priest and the HellRaisers. An upper bracket match, loser of this isn't out of it, but the winner of this will already punch their ticket to the main phase past the group stage. So interesting development here. Both teams smoke up into the other team's jungle. Gonna place some observer wards here. This one will block this camp. Priest, not so much. But yeah, won't be any action. Let's take a quick look at the lineup, starting with the HellRaisers. We've got Afon NJ on that Tiny. We've got Shashlo working towards this bottom lane on the Beastmaster. Mirana, played by Stanley here. I'm just going to call him Yamaha. I think he was called in on their website. The Apathy, well-known player here in the scene, playing the Bane support. And that leaves Goddamn on that Ball of Light, the Wisp.
And up here on, is it Priest?
Priest, yeah.
Okay. Kat will be on the Earthshaker. We've got Miposhka on the Tusk, a relatively well-known player. Barash is going to be here on the Queen of Pain. We'll have Metbum on the Silencer, and last but not least, it's Bogdwajan on Phantom Lancer. I've butchered these names.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
It's really hard, especially the Phantom Lancer. I think Rapture nailed it the other night when we were casting the finals. Bogdwajan, it's kind of rolls off the tongue if you have a little bit of practice, but But yeah, with Tiny mid, kind of classic combo, Gotham already has his bottle, of course, but nice actual fissure block coming actually in. Only one level onto Queen of Pain, and the Wisp was still healthy behind that. But I mean, Poshka's here too, they really want to kill this Tiny in the... Oh wow! They get the first blood here with the freaking ice shards after the fissure, just blocking him indefinitely, it feels like. Barash almost dying to the Wisp return, but now Gotham is in trouble. He's hitting quite heftily, and now Barash, he gets the Shadow Strike off, but Devon Ninja comes in with the stun. Doesn't have any.
He does have another one for 12
though,
seconds.
So he just needs to try and walk up, and Wisp just dies to the damage over time after the extra bit of burst of the fissure, and this mid lane already going different from what we would have expected normally.
Yeah, it's an absolute disaster, and I'm not sure what Goddamn was doing. He was just sitting on a full bottle not really healing anyone up. He had Tether, and he was just like, Afro Ninja, you got caught out. Sorry, bud, you're dead.
Yeah. I mean, he did have the Shadow Strike on him, but those are ticked instances, so you have some time to build up at least a little bit and not die to these kind of things. I mean, the first pick of for Afro Ninja, it's just pretty good play from Priest with the excellent Fissure Block, and then...
But on bot,
maybe Toshka?
We've got Tosk going down. He's taking a lot of damage. One more right click will do it. And even with Mirana's somewhat lackluster early game damage, they're able to bring him down.
Well, there's a little bit of burst on that arrow here if you manage to get it on a decent length. That's exactly what the Bane allows you to, so no surprise to see them do well there. Yeah, I was just not ready to go into this kind of crazy game already, I gotta tell you too.
CIS Dota,
not quite
man.
Yet in the mode, but yeah. It's exactly how Priest's games yesterday have been running as well. Another interesting part is this offlane dual lane with a Phantom Lancer and the Silencer up against the Beastmaster. It's also not something that you see every day. Shasha should be alright.
I find it odd that he goes for Glaives of Wisdom first, though. Especially against Beastmaster, who has somewhat mana problems. He's actually got two mangoes, just because he knows he's got those mana problems so much.
Well, yes, the last word now is going to use that to try and farm up one of these boars.
Beastmaster's already almost level 4. As bot lane, the Apathy, getting caught out here, he will be okay though.
Not quite blocked off, so they'll be doing fine. But yeah, but that Beastmaster's an offlaner generally, so he isn't really necessarily used to getting that much experience, but he is used of not getting too many CS, and even that is working relatively well in his favor. 9 CS as opposed to 15 of the Phantom Lancer is quite good for this kind of situation, so... They're getting ahead there. They're getting ahead bottom lane with the Mirana getting pretty much free farm, even leaving the Bane to do something else, to go back to base right now, pick up his boots,
and
then come back.
And she's going to be going straight for Ring of Aquila, it looks like.
And the middle lane is the only thing that didn't really come off to a good start for the HellRaisers, but they're starting to come back. You're already 14 lasts on Tiny as opposed to 7 off the Queen of Pain. Barash, this is the point where he has to be careful, because anytime he gets close, he will just receive a combo here with the Avalanche Toss, and that is a lot of harassment.
Yeah, Avalanche Toss can pretty much insta-give most heroes up to about level 7 or 8. At which point it starts falling off in terms of damage, just because heroes get tankier. Shashlo a little bit out of position there, but he does manage to get back under his tower.
And that last tank build that he had enables him to cut down one of these trees to actually get back to safety. Otherwise, Octavio John would have actually been in range to finish him off. But hey, there's the turnaround. Shashlo comes in. God, I'm linked up with him. Do they have any lockdowns? Doesn't look like it, but do they need it with all the slows as well as the burn? Med Pump will fall. And Phantom Lancer. All thing you can do is just leave his body to die. That's a problem with this kind of a dual lane. You don't really have any sort of way to control anyone, and at least with Wisp you do have that slow. Also, not even mentioning the boss from the Beastmaster doing a really tremendous job with that.
Yeah, and Beastmaster is still holding on to these two tangos thanks to the bottle charges Goddamn was able to give him. And here comes that Avalanche Toss combo. It doesn't quite finish him off though. Queen of Pain managing to live here.
Yeah, but just so hard still, Barash. I mean, he can't really get too close because there's also some extra movement speed here if Gotham's tethered up, so even that kind of an area which should be safe.
Is that a bottle cry?
You should be.
Huh.
There it is.
Oh, here we go. Or he's just gonna walk back. Yep. I mean, it's fine. He's gonna have gold for a TP. And he might have. He did realize, actually, with this ward up here, that Bane was coming into the mid lane, and he just wanted to get out of the lane right then. So standing there and bottle crowing, not having your bottle for a bit, and possibly getting killed could have been disastrous. Whereas just walking back to base wastes the Bane's time as well. So
at the same time, still the Queen of Pain that's being shut down really, really hard, and Earthshaker is not really having the impact that he's been looking for. I mean, sure, he managed to grab them these first two kills, but is that really going to be enough to offset the disadvantage that Barash is going to be ending up with now?
Yeah, and Tusk has been almost forced out of XP range, like he's actually in the offlane on this bottom lane, just because of the fact that Mirana Bane can kill you.
Oh yeah.
Just arrow, nightmare, well, other way around, but it's really easy to get kills with that combo. Oh, now Shashlo
is going to
grab that
with
Barash.
There's a Fissure Block here, nicely done. Shasha should be dying. Is there any sort of rotation? No, they're just leaving him for dead. But there's four heroes up top here for Priest to make this happen. That's just more space in middle lane. Poshka, he's in this though. He snacked up that rune, and now Barash comes back in a little bit of overhead, a little bit of a lot of burst. And they did not see that coming here with the task coming, providing that extra bit of control. Now for Ninja, one more right click will do it. Not with the stick charges. He eats a tango, but he's kind of ran himself into a little bit of a pickle. Barash dies to the burst from the toss as well as the tower. So at least making them work for the Hellraisers. Giving us some interesting plays here.
Yeah, and Shashlo up top, he had two tangos, of course, he could have popped that and gotten enough mana.
Oh, there's
for
the
roar.
It wouldn't have come out of anything yet. It's being slowed down as well from the ball, and there's Goddamn with the extra bit of help to ensure the kill, so very nicely done, just getting something else off the map. Meanwhile, the bottom lane, still free farm for Morana.
Yeah, I really like the way Shashlo is playing here. He's being very conservative with his mana. I've rarely seen him at less than half mana in this lane. And usually with Beastmaster, you rely on spamming out those axes to get last hits, and Silencer can really pressure you to kind of blow your mana on stuff that may not be that useful. And Shashlo's just paced it out very well. He's kept a level head about it. So
yep.
Meanwhile, Tiny's going to be mid alone for a moment, and they're looking to do something here.
They just have to get in close for Fissure, but without the Sonic Wave, you're lacking a lot of that burst component that you really need up against a Tiny, because even at this point, he is almost 1200 health points with the Dreads. Meanwhile, top though, oh hello, they do get the Tusk. Not quite sure how that happened, but yeah. Octavo John, he's out of mana and has to try and run away, will be able to bank some vision now, goddamn. Take a lot of damage from the Graves as well as a couple of these illusions, but Phantom Lancer. Oh wow, what's happening here? Buyback from him? Parush dies to leap up from Morana? Oh my god.
Mirage, there was an arrow fired at him, but a creep got hit by it,
okay.
I think. At least Morana stayed out of my way, so that's what I was assuming.
There's action all over the place. My poor voice.
But it looks like Miposhka may look to go in here. He's been spotted by the boar.
Yeah. He won't surprise anyone here. And yeah, goddamn, also still very low. It's kind of really lucky that Phantom Lancer didn't actually have enough mana for Fallen Mother Lands, or else it would have been a collateral kill there, but it was not to be.
Just a little bit of animal cruelty going on as he punches the boar.
Oh well. Why, man? Why? Peter will be so sad. But yeah, they're putting on pressure now on this tower. They even dragged the creeper along, so it's essentially a double wave with like four range creeps bashing away. This charge alone can't really do anything about this roar or not, so they're just gonna let this go. It's kind of inevitable at this point, but they got more than enough out this lane for the Beastmaster. We of course already saw him use this roar. He's at level 7,
now,
almost
PL...
8 right now.
I'm assuming PRIES wants to keep up this pressure, mainly because PL has picked up a Vlad's, and that's going to give you a 5 armor aura against what's mostly going to be the physical damage of Beastmaster's axes. That's going to be very, very useful early on. Beastmaster, though, is really wanting to push. He's going for that Necronomicon.
Yep.
And, not really sure what Mirana's game plan is right now, but she's going to... Oh, barely miss that arrow.
What was it, mid? On Barush? Yeah, okay.
It was, over here. Queen of Pain just popped
okay.
up.
Okay. Well, first Moonlight Shadow of the game, not really doing too much.
Oh! Actually, it's getting Afro Ninja some movement in mid. He'll throw the Sonic Wave, but Afro Ninja will still secure the kill.
Oh, that's a turnaround. Maybe
coming in with a snowball.
The relocate out is there in time, and they can potentially turn this around. They're not in range of tower, but they're in range of Karr. Who does
they
have
do have
combo,
though.
Oh, it's gonna be quicker here. They bring him back. They do get the toss avalanche onto Miposhka. Quite bring him down, but at least chase them off. The Apathy also joins the party. Got him quite low on health after the burst. The Apathy gets a little bit lucky there, I guess, being pushed into that particular tree area, so they will be safe. So, nice gambit there, turning around. And
yeah, and nice escape there. Yeah, Hellraiser's just buying time with that fountain and knowing that, okay, they're all going to be here. Get some extra heroes in the lane and we'll be fine.
Yeah, absolutely.
I do find it strange, though, that Wisp still has no boots. He's gone for Bottle Urn before boots here. And with Queen of Pain being able to run you down, same with Phantom Lancer and Tusk, I guess they're not extremely necessary, because even if you have boots, they're still going to catch up to you.
Yep.
I'd like to see them, you know?
There's very few heroes that can really get away with no boots. Wisp is one of them in certain situations, and this is definitely one of them. So, and that now allows you to just... to go all out on the region. And you're gonna be linked up with either Tiny or anyone else for the most part anyway, and use them as a screen, essentially, so you don't really have to run away. If it gets to a point where you have to run away as a Wisp at this stage in the game, you already lost the fight, and at that point it doesn't really matter. There's a relocate, though.
Relocate.
It's gonna go on to Metpom. He is spotted out by something, I guess the Hawk here.
The bird.
And that is a really, really good combination to have. Just the Hawk.
Oh, but meanwhile in the bot lane. We're happy to see a Starstorm, a Brain Sap, and one right-click take down the Tusk. Earthshaker will go down, but Queen of Pain able to bring down the Mirana in exchange. Bane just nightmaring up Queen of Pain and saying, I'm getting out of here. So, non-stop action once again here.
Simultaneously as well. It's really hard to keep up sometimes. But yeah, 3-for-1 trade at the end of it all. Priest actually getting the upper hand, all things considered, because Barush, as well as the Phantom Lance, are getting quite a bit of gold off of that Mirana kill. It was quite highly farmed, but... yeah, that's the problem that I see for the Hellraisers, even though they're now starting to take objectives here with the Sacred Book of Chasha, even though they're starting to do quite well again on Afro Ninja as well, and Afro Ninja as well as the Mirana. There's still a Phantom Lance that's farming, right? He does have the Blads already, and so that's gonna give him some much needed sustain. And then...
not to mention a Yasha.
Oh, hello.
Avatos. Yeah.
There's Global Science coming out, but do they care? Barush with a 3-man Sonic Wave! Bakhtar Vajang comes in, still under cover of the Global Science. They're all still alive, somehow. But that's going to end soon. Three heroes down, only for the price of the Tusk. Excellent Global Science, excellent reactions. And really well timed rotation here from Bakhtar Vajang. That as well. Hits three heroes there.
Yeah.
From the back line.
That's 2k gold on Queen of Pain right now.
What's she
gonna
go
for? Well, not anymore, but yeah.
Right.
Probably going to go for the Axe. As much as they want to fight, Axe is going to be amazing here.
Yep.
So, the Apathy, it looks like he's working on a Glimmer as well.
Yeah, it's probably the best item that you can go for, especially as a Bane. Just, Global Silence.
Unless
you're
just loaded.
Yeah. Global Silence will still drop you out of your ultimate, so it's not really that good for that, or even a Fissure or something like, along those lines. But, okay, there's a Fiend's Grip. And the relocate. Hello, that's just sneaky. The Apathy was just standing inside there, just waiting for someone to come by. It's only Miposhka, but now they might find someone else. Card lifts it up to the air and will force it down here. And the relocate back out. That was very
efficient.
That was
2 kills for 1 relocate.
Yeah.
It was just... I mean, efficiency at its finest here. And Hellraisers, they may have lost 2 players recently, but they seem to be just fine.
Still some talent here between these players, especially if Ninja and got down there. Pretty damn strong when it comes to that. It looks like they're now setting up for Roshan. They do have the Necro Creeps here, they do have the arrow to help them out a little bit. Do they have the damage? It looks like it. Force Tiny. Being quite nice in the damage department here with only 1 level up in this ultimate.
Not to mention that level 1 Necro Book. I mean, it's only a 5% speed bonus, but it's enough to do something. And with that and 1 point in Inner Beast, it's a good bit of attack speed to help them out. So they may not have a medallion, but they do have enough damage to take it down. And Mirana appears to be going for Maelstrom. Bit old school, but so is the core Mirana pick.
Yep. Core Mirana is very... It's not really ideal in most circumstances. Oh, hang on, the Apathy. Getting Snowball up top here. Barush is there as well. That should be an easy pickup.
Nope.
He gets the... he's making a fight for it here. Having to use the ultimate without an Aghanim Scepter just for the Bane kill on a tier 2. That's a win on itself for Hellraisers there. They will probably lose the tower. But they're going to trade an Afro Ninja. I also have the Wisp behind him if they want to relocate. But there's no one else.
Yeah, this
going
Tiny already has Blink Drums, so he's got the mobility he needs to get these kills. It's going to be very easy for him to kind of snowball into an Aghanim Scepter. And at that point, Hellraisers have push. Like, they have no worries about push. With the Beastmaster's aura and his small army that he's building now that he's picking up level 2 Necro Book, it's going to be no trouble for them to just tear down towers very quickly.
It's going to be a problem for them if they keep losing their towers, though. I mean, that's a tier 2 for tier 1 exchange, essentially. With a little bit of farm going the way of, I think, Mirana here outside of middle lane. Do Hellraisers really walk away the winners here, or do you think they should have contested that instead of going for the trade?
I think they can afford to lose towers just because of their late game push potential. They have, like, the global presence of Io, the escape from Mirana ulti, as well as relocate. They've got options in the late game to push, so losing a tower here and there is not the worst thing in the world. Of course, you want to avoid it, but
It might lose some more heroes as well, as Tiny and Wisp are setting up on a high ground even without a relocate, so you have that available as an escape tool if you need it. They might need some more help, because the entirety of Priest's lineup is down here in this general area. Barish dropping quite low. If there's a Hog, they're spotting that out. It could be potentially devastating, and there it is, it's on the way. We'll get sniped off though by some light eye shots, so it's... Tusk has been on point for that, so Poshka always trying to find these... whenever he sees these Hogs running about, he always throws the eye shots out. Just to make sure to deny the vision, which is so crucial up against the Beastmaster, plus a Whisper Locate.
Even at max level, that Hawk, if you see it coming, you can kill it. It's no problem at all, so. And Beastmaster, about 300 gold away from level 3 Necrobook, and I think that's going to be Hellraiser's time when they say, okay, now is the time to push. We can hit these towers hard. Tiny's still a little ways to go on the Ags, but that's almost luxury for Afro Ninja here. With the way he's playing, he just wants to get kills.
Yep. It's very interesting. I mean, sometimes you see Tiny just go for the treads and then into Axe. Sometimes even with the blink before, but the jumps as well. Just make sure, hell no, that's a dead Earthshaker, Axe or no Axe.
Yep.
And that's exactly what the blink does for you. Even with the whip, you kind of want that anyway, regardless whether you want to go for a quicker Axe or not. That's a global science, so I'm not quite... There we go, that's a fight. They do get the Bane only for it, though. And that is super worth it here. HellRaisers will be very, very confident in pushing down his tier 2 now with that big ultimate on cooldown.
Yeah, it's like they just really hate Bane. Because they've used a Sonic Wave on him without Axe, so it's like a 2-minute cooldown there. Then you use Global Silence on pretty much just a Bane. And sure, it secures a kill, but if you're a support, you're happy to die there. You're just like, okay, whatever. They wasted two big ults on me. And got nothing else for it, basically.
Relocate.
There's gonna be a relocate up top.
Ah, they do get the arrow onto Barash here. Toss forward, plus the blink. They do get that. Nice little snipe there from Yamaha. He's kind of caught inside a tree line, it looks like, but he will be able to leap out in 20 seconds. Very nice snipe off there. Well, bottom lane, what's going on here?
Did you see that escape?
I did. Goddamn. I didn't quite, but I got the tail end of it.
Shoshlo's standing nearby, and as soon as the relocate comes in, he just gathers out and. There was almost no time for Priest to react.
Yeah, it's kind of looks like Hellraiser's kind of running circles on Priest at this point. It's took them a while to kind of get used to how they're playing, how aggressive they're playing. But now they're at a point where Hellraiser's can almost sense what Priest wants to do, and then just do the exact thing that they need to stop that from happening. They group up when Priest is looking for pickoffs, and. They do get pickups themselves when Priest is just distributing themselves too much, relying on their mobility to get out, but then they're just being outplayed. Nicely placed arrows here, good relocates there. That's exactly how you want to play a Mirana lineup as well as a Wisp lineup.
Yeah, and they're hitting their item timings perfectly. I mean, Wisp is almost to a mech at this point.
Yep.
And he's just picked up a casual belt of strength here just to... Well, keep his pants up, I guess, but it's going to keep him alive. It's going to give him those extra stats that he really needs, because in all honesty, Wisp doesn't need that much mana, especially with the mana boots up. So just grabbing this casual belt is going to give him more than enough health to survive in these team fights, I think.
Yeah, definitely sure, unless he's being focused on by like the Phantom Lance or something. And Bogdan with John, he does have the Refusal Blade. He's still top farm in this game. Funnily enough here, also owed to the fact Tiny does not have the Magnum Scepter just yet, so his farm rate isn't all that ridiculous. But is that really going to be enough for Phantom Lancer, right? Yes, only one target that you can really lock down or blow up a reasonable amount of time. And then even then, if that target has so much more health than mana, like a Beastmaster even, then you're all of a sudden you're missing out on a lot of damage. I mean, one of the nerfs to the Phantom Lancer was the stat gain as well. And believe it or not, that starts stacking up because the illusions are also not benefiting from that extra agility that he's missing now. So himself, he's hitting less, his illusions are hitting less, and that starts adding up on this kind of hero as well.
Yeah, and
they're smoked up now, looking for goddamn, they will blow him up. There's a global science even once again. I don't really agree. And
again, they use two big ults to pick off a Wisp. Queen of Pain does have Ags now, but still, the one big ult then. And you get a Wisp for it. I'm sure Wisp is just sitting there like, so what?
Yeah. I mean,
my carry is farming. We are fine, team. Don't worry.
Wisp still is getting closer to the mechanism as we were talking about. So, and Wisp, as long as you have your level 6, any death you can do to create space is like, all right, whatever. It's a Wisp. No one cares.
This Wisp still has 5 kills and 4 assists, though. So he is doing some work. But meanwhile, they will roar the PL, and PL is dead.
So quick, yeah, after the Moonlight Shadow. That's the use for pick up.
I mean, they
now
don't only have the Nightmare to set up the arrow, they have toss. If it's tossed straight up in the air, well, you're gonna land that arrow most of the time. And of course, you have the lore, which...
Yeah, it's just another instant pick up here. Relocate down to the bottom lane. Now that is pushing in. All of a sudden, Priest, 2 heroes down. One of them is the highest farmed hero, and the other one is the big tempo controller in teamfight, so that'll be at least a tier 2. Going down the drain. HellRaisers, they get the objectives after any sort of pickoffs, and they utilize, in fact, they're abusing the, kind of liberal use from the global science there for Metro. Sunwave comes out, not doing too much after Ninja, of course, he's being constantly healed up by Garthan, and this tower already down. That's an axe on a tiny. When did he complete that? Must have been a while ago, because he already has 2700 gold again.
He completed it at 20 minutes. I thought you caught it, so I didn't mention it.
Yeah.
Plus, I've been harping on about items this entire cast. I'm just like, yeah, and such and such has this. I definitely have depth to my casting here, Dragon Drop Kappa.
Oh, well.
And there's the mech. So, 1600 to Guardian Greaves at 22 minutes. This is the support dream. Okay? You have 3 sources of healing now, and then a wand. Not to mention, you've got a little bit of a luxury belt at this point.
Yep. Well, if it's
the only
it
downside
nice,
is he doesn't have a slot for TP.
Oh, well, do you really need the TP, right? I mean,
yeah,
stuck
with
that
relocate.
We got relocate, so it's
just get your refresher. Infinite TPs, we're good.
But yeah, Priest are definitely feeling pressure now. They're smoked up inside their own base, trying to look for something. HellRaisers at a point where just splitting up a little bit, trying to get the farm that they need, or that they want, essentially.
Bane. And they just parked this bird in the pit, just saying, okay, when Roche comes up, we take Roche. Easy.
Bane has his Glimmer Cape, Morana. Working on
there is the smoke.
Mental Star, it looks like. But yeah, if the smoke, if they can reap the rewards of that and get Alpha Ninja, that would be great. Of course, he's sitting at very high net worth going into the Soldier Rush now. They do find Hogarthan first. Global Science again. And yeah, Tiny does have TP scroll, and he gets out just before the fissure comes out. Once again, I have to question the decision to just blow that without having enough intelligence to know where everyone else
is.
This is
me playing Silencer, Dragon Drop. Like, this is the stuff I do. That's not a good thing.
I can't agree, knowing how you play.
Hey guys, an isolated hero, let's press R. Wait a second, should I have done that?
That is a 130-second cooldown for Wisp. That's a hero that's a throwaway hero at this point.
I mean, he is quite farmed.
Yeah, no.
But wouldn't you want to kill off the Morana or the Tiny? Or, like, take a big team fight with it?
Because
if they don't have their abilities, they can't kill off Phantom Lancer. But HellRaisers are kind of engaging in a way that says, okay, we're only sending one or two heroes into the fight at a time. And then Silencer kind of has to go for these mediocre ults.
Yep.
And now look, they're going to go group up. But they're going for Roche at a time when Roche has just spawned, first of all. Not to mention, Silencer doesn't have global. So what are they going to do?
Yeah, they can't do anything. I mean, I think
they
big
think
part
they
of it is
something.
Just...
They're coming.
Yeah, I think big part of it is actually just a lack of aggressive vision. They have some wards up onto... hang on, there's a smoke. And there's God blowing up after the Moonlight Shadow comes out. Kato gets it with an arrow shot though. Caught in front of it. He does not get his ultimate off just yet. Now the dust comes out revealing absolutely everyone. But oh, Baran and Apo Ninja, they're just going ham. Barash caught with the Nightmares. 3 heroes already fell. And 3 heroes gather up around him. That should be dead. Queen of Pain, maybe? He tried to teleport out. That is hopeful. That is just very hopeful. 4 for 2 trade. Roshan still in the pocket.
He's not to mention a full AC.
Tiny.
For Tiny.
And full AC. Oh man, that's coming out in the career right now. This is where
that,
the game gets
it took
really
him
hard.
5 minutes to farm a whole AC. That's like 1,000 gold per minute at the moment. Of course, through the whole game, he's averaging 630, but...
Oh, only 630?
Still.
Wow. Scrub.
Feels like more than that.
It does indeed, and now these racks are in peril. I mean, There's no back to region. There's a glyph to try to delay just a little bit. Queen of Pain can buy back if they really want to defend this, but it's already too late. The main barracks are down, and now HellRaisers force them to buy back. They will walk themselves out of the end and might lose the apathy. But the Gloomy Cape will ensure his safe retreat, so...
I mean, I don't think the apathy really cares about dying at this point.
Yeah, probably. It looks like they want to make something happen here. Look at how they're hiding, Alpha Ninja. In the trees up there. Piranha's being spotted out. From the tower vision, I guess? No, Alpha Ninja shows himself, he probably got caught outside of the base. Gets a snowball off though, Ness with a nicely timed global silence. Alpha Ninja isolated from the rest of the scene. But the Glimmer Cape will not be stopped, and he still has his Aegis, and he's still even alive with a mechanism from Gotham. And the heal's coming, yeah. Silence of Dice on the backline. Here's Marana goes to town. And yeah, Tusk made himself a nice little arena, but no one else dies just yet instead of Priest. But they've used all of their spells. I mean, obviously, yeah. Queen of Pain ultimate, very low cooldown with that axe. Earthshaker, though, still doesn't have that Echo Slam. He used it in Rosh fight. And the Global Silence once again. This was well timed, but it's already too late in the game. You've already given up too much. Not finding these.
And not to mention, they've got so much attack speed on Tiny. Like, even without Beastmaster and the Necronomicon near him, he's at like a quarter or a half a second per attack. When Beastmaster and pops his Necronomicon and walks right up to him, he does so much more damage. Now, he may get caught out here, but he's got the Blink, the Aegis, and the Relocate back to the fountain.
Yeah. Do they want to turn us around?
Come back and kill them.
Yeah, the Apathy and Charger, they're still hanging around. They want this kill. They bring him back. Most likely, Barrett's still tank in front, and yeah, Battle Blink out there. And now they're on the run. Miposhka caught with a Nightmare, and that'll be the desired target for them. They get the Snowball off. The Apathy got on front lines here. The Roar comes out onto the Queen of Pain, though. That's what they were looking for. Glimmercape will keep him safe for the time being. Tiny alone does not quite have enough damage, but there gets the Avalanche up. Swings his axe, and that's two heroes. But Nine Legacy Slam in the back gets himself double kill on that Earthshake with Alpha Ninja. That was only his Aegis. They used like two buybacks already, at least.
Yeah, and I was even bought back to try and make his way into the fight.
And now the Snowball being forced out. With two heroes inside of it, Alpha Ninja just starts swinging. After the Avatars and Miposhka is dead, caught as well. One more swing is all it'll take there. We'll have a gem somewhere. Now, Shashlo, and yeah, that's a GG.
Good lord.
That Tiny is just way too huge. They did not account for him. They...
Desso! Just like the BM Desa there at the end, just like, yeah.
This is just
I didn't tell your towers fast enough, so let's get a little more negative armor.
This is purely to mess with the stats, guys. Because they're just on Dota now.
I can join you for like the first half of the next game for sure.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Since this one was quick.
Yeah, what a game, man. So much progression. So much kills all over the place, simultaneous kills wherever you look. My camera work was abysmal.